The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you both.
And also with you.
As we gather in our Lord's presence, together we pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, has taught us that what we do for the least of your children, we do also for him. Give us the will to serve others, as he was the servant of all, who gave up his life and died for us, but lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's prepare our hearts for the proclamation of God's word.
A reading from 2 Samuel. Then all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, "Look, we are your bone and flesh. For some time, while Saul was king over us, it was you who led out of Israel and brought it in. The Lord said to you, 'It is you who shall be a shepherd of my people Israel. You who shall be ruler over Israel.' So all the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and King David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord and the anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 40 years. At Hebron, he reigned over Judah 7 years and 6 months. And at Jerusalem, he reigned over all Israel and Judah for 33 years. David occupied the stronghold and named it the City of David. David built the city all around from the middle inwards, and David became greater and greater, for the Lord, the God of hosts, was with him." Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Our appointed psalm is Psalm 48, found on page 765. We will read it alternately, verse by verse. Page 765, Psalm 48. Great is the Lord and highly to be praised. In the city of our God is his holy hill.
Beautiful and lofty, the joy of all the earth, is the hill of Zion, the very center of the world, and the city of the great king.
God is in her citadels. He is known to be her sure refuge.
Behold, the kings of the earth assemble and march forward together.
They looked and were astounded. They retreated and fled in terror.
Trembling seas and air, they writhe like a woman in childbirth, like ships of the sea when the east wind shatters them.
As we have heard, so have we seen. In the city of the Lord of hosts, in the city of our God, God has established her forever.
We have waited in silence on your loving kindness, O God, in in the midst of your temple.
Your praise, like your name, O God, reaches to the world's end. Your right hand is full of justice.
Let the Mount of Zion be glad, and the cities of Judah rejoice, because of your judgments.
Make the circuit of Zion, walk around about her, count the number of her towers.
Consider well her bulwarks, examine her strongholds, that you may tell those who come after.
This God is our God forever and ever. He shall be our guide forevermore. Together with prayer. Gracious God, you have made us fellow citizens with the saints in the city of your eternal life.
In the time of storm and the foundation's shake, teach us to wait in silence on your steadfast and transforming love. Make known to us in Jesus Christ our Lord.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Corinthians. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, and I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into the paradise and heard things that were not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, or I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. To keep me from being too elated, 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made weak perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that he has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this a carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out 2 by 2, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake off the dust that has on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord, as we come into your presence this day, may your Holy Spirit open our hearts that we would know. Lord Jesus, we pray. Please be seated. Jesus left that place and came to his own town. In this account from Mark's Gospel that we just heard about Jesus' experience of returning to his hometown, it indicates to us that the people who had known Jesus as he was growing up had come to a conclusion about who he was. And they had come to a conclusion that he had limits in his ability. And they were not going to be open to the reality that he might not be who they had concluded him to be. But that's not really a surprise, is it? I mean, we all do that. It's a strange part of human nature. We don't expect great things from those that we grew up with. And that can be for a number of reasons. Maybe we've witnessed them struggling with things in life that came a bit easier for us, so we conclude that they have less stability than us. We may have seen them not looking or being their best, perhaps because of lack of sleep or being overwhelmed by things going on in their lives that we weren't even aware of. Or perhaps we never actually took the time to get to know them, especially if they were a child. We don't have a tendency to engage with many people about the mysteries and the wonders of life, and we rarely sit down and do that with children. On the Sabbath, Jesus began to teach. On the day when everyone is encouraged to spend time reflecting on God and life and priorities. The Sabbath is not just rest from making things or rest from working. It's rest from the need to make something of ourselves. And perhaps that is why the people were struggling so much with Jesus, the Jesus they are now encountering, the one who's teaching with wisdom and healing with great power. From early in our lives, we picked up on the nuance that our value is contingent upon our abilities, what we can do and accomplish. And the greater one's ability in any given area, well, the more rewarded that person will be. So from an early age, we all strive to make something of ourselves so that we will be set apart from others, so that we will have more value. As adults, it's actually easier to move to a place where you're not known so that your past struggles and failures stay behind you. Jesus said to them, prophets are not without honor except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house. People who have known them and experienced them throughout their lives find it difficult to be open to someone different than they have already made a judgment. But Jesus is referring here to prophets, not just the people in general. Prophets are those whom God is working through and speaking through. It's not actually a reference to the individual's abilities. It's a reference to God accepting and working through someone in a life-changing and life-giving way. It is God affirming a person. This is saying that we struggle with the reality that God does not perceive people the way we perceive people. We struggle with the reality that God will freely pour blessing upon people that we would not freely pour blessing upon people. On the Sabbath, Jesus began to teach in the synagogue, a and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? Are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. They are saying that he has been blessed by God in a way they have never seen before, because what is happening is greater than what is humanly possible. It's what they're witnessing, it's what they're observing. The deeds of power and the deeds of wisdom are wonders and beauties to behold. They're not taking offense at the wisdom or the power. They're taking offense at such wisdom and power is incarnated in a human being. And Jesus was amazed at their unbelief. They are not denying the wisdom. They are not denying the power. They are denying the incarnation. They are denying that God's love and care for us would be so astounding that God would be born of a woman and submit God's self to the fullness of being human, entering the world as an infant, dependent upon their mother and others, to experience all that we experience as children making our way in a confusing and uncertain world, but coming out the other end not driven to make something of self, but to love others and to care for others. They long for God not to be like us, but they cannot embrace the reality that God would reveal that God is not like us by becoming. And Jesus was amazed at their unbelief. For such unbelief proclaims that God can only act and behave in ways that fit with my understanding and expectation of God. Perhaps that's why we struggle seeing the greatness and the potential of others, because we look upon the flaws that we see in them and struggle with the reality that those flaws do not prevent God's love and grace being poured into their life. If God embraces and accepts them, then we are on very shaky ground if we do not embrace and accept them. If Jesus is indeed the Word made flesh, that is a proclamation of God's love and acceptance of all. Jesus did not turn any away. There were many who turned away from Jesus, but Jesus did not turn any away. And he could not do any deed of power there. Why? Because they turned away from him. They would not accept him. Jesus moved on to other villages. Jesus sent others out to other villages and towns. And he ordered them to take nothing for their journey. He ordered them to go in such a way that they would need others. He ordered them to go without any social power, without any power. He ordered them to surrender their social power. And with no social power, the relationships they would be building with people would be based on grace and mercy, love and care for one another. It is the same relationship that God invites us into through Christ. The one with all wisdom and power comes to us to love us and care for us and welcome us. We are welcomed and loved because of who we are, but simply because Christ comes to us. It is who God is. It is God's grace and love poured out to us. And we, like those people in his hometown, are simply left with the question, will we welcome him? Will we embrace him? Will we be filled and touched by his grace and love? Lord Jesus, we come into your presence this day to celebrate who you are and what you have done for us. Holy Spirit, fill our hearts with joy and knowing, and may we be touched by your grace and love and mercy. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Please stand together and turn to page 188. The words of the Nicene Creed. Let us confess our faith as we say. We believe in one God, the Father and the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, for him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And in our Lord's presence and prayer, I invite you to stand securely.
You are the God of highest heaven, yet you have mercy on your people when they call on you. Hear the prayers we offer. We pray for the peoples of the world, for all who suffer from persecution and oppression, for those who suffer hardship because of others' cruelty, greed, or indifference. Send us out to proclaim your gospel of justice and peace, that we may, with all your people, may repent our ways and live together in harmony. God of grace, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for your church, for its clergy, for Linda, our primate, Lynn, our metropolitan, John, our bishop, Alan, our rector, Lori, our curate, Larry, our deacon, and Brent, the bishop of the Diocese of the Northern Philippines. We pray for those who proclaim your good news, for those who are persecuted for their faith, for those who have lost their faith or wandered far from you. Send us out to proclaim your gospel of righteousness and truth, that we and all your people may repent of our ways and live as your faithful people. God of grace, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for this community, for those with whom we live and work, our families and our friends, for those who are victims of ignorance or intolerance. Send us out to proclaim your gospel of reconciliation and love, that we may repent of our ways and live as a caring and hospitable people. God of grace, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all in need, for those who are frightened, lonely, or sad, for those we turn away from, and those whose needs we ignore, for the sick. And in our parish, we remember Dave Divitt, Sheila, Joy, Esther, and Ella. We pray for the dying and all who care for them. Send us out to proclaim your gospel of healing and hope, that we may repent of our ways and bring comfort and consolation to your people. God of grace, in your mercy, we remember all who have died in the faith, those who have spread your gospel in every generation. When we stray from your path, call us to repentance. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to follow in the footsteps of your prophets and saints, that with them We may come at last to stand in your presence, for you are our God forever and ever. God of grace, in your mercy. Amen. And this week we congratulate David and Glenda Eno on their wedding anniversary. And now we offer the promised prayer, a prayer for the litten fire. O God, you are our refuge and our strength, our help in times of trouble. Have mercy on the lands and communities devastated by fires, and especially the people of the village of Litten and Litten First Nations. Have mercy on those who have lost homes and livelihoods. Protect those who have had to evacuate. Bless and keep safe all firefighters. And strengthen those who seek to rebuild hope that all may face the future without fear. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
We continue in prayer. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, may the peace of the Lord be with you. We take a moment to reflect in our hearts our peace with God in Christ. Let us pray. God of heaven and earth, receive our sacrifice of praise and strengthen us for the perfect freedom of your service. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We continue with Eucharistic Prayer 2, volume 896. Let The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death and banish the darkness of sin and despair. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same way he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you do this, you do it in memory of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your Holy Church, gathering into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit, in the Holy Church, now and forever. Bottom of page 211. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Number 1 on page 212. I am the bread of life, says the Lord. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him. This is the table not of the righteous, but of the poor in spirit. It has been made ready for those who love Christ and those who want to love God in Christ. So come, you who have much faith and you who have little. You who come to this sacrament often and you who have not been for a long time or ever before. You who have tried to follow Jesus and all of us who have failed. Come not because it is I who invite you, it is Christ who invites you to meet him. Thank you. pray. O God, may we who have shared in holy things never fail to serve you in your word. And so come to the fullness of joy in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and forevermore.
My brothers and sisters in Christ, go forth in peace to love and serve our Lord.
Thanks be to God.